My name is Stefanie Hundehege. I'm a researcher at the German Literature Archive in Marbach, and this is Narrating Africa. The German Literature Archive in Marbach is one of the most important literary institutions in the world. It holds in its collections some of the most valuable documents and sources of literature and intellectual history between the 18th century and the present day. The archive currently houses roughly 1,400 collections that are connected to individual authors and scholars, but also entire publishing houses. The library houses the largest collection on modern German literature. It consists of nearly 1 million volumes, including more than 160 private libraries, previously owned by writers or book collectors. The institution's origins date back to the 19th century, when in 1835, a local group founded the first German Poet Society, dedicated to Marbach-born author Friedrich Schiller. This society was founded exactly 30 years after Schiller's death, which demonstrates the admiration and literary renown he had already achieved during his lifetime, particularly for his dramatic texts and philosophical essays. Today, Schiller is considered one of the most important German authors of all time, and his plays, poems, and contributions to philosophy have become canonical texts in schools, universities, and theaters. In 1903, the Society inaugurated this building to house and make available to the public its collection of Schiller artifacts, portraits, busts, and letters. Today, it is called the Schiller National Museum and still shows an exhibition dedicated to the writer. But slowly, the Society expanded its collection to include other, initially mostly regional, authors. In 1955, the German Literature Archive was founded with the idea specifically of broadening the collection's scope from a regional to a national level. In 1972, the archive moved into a new building that was constructed next to the museum. This building offered more space for the archive's rapidly growing collections, which now included, among other things, the Cotter Publishing Archive. Dating back to about 1800, the Cotter Publishing House had counted many of the most prolific German writers among its authors. The German Literature Archive also focused on collecting materials, letters, drafts, manuscripts, and sketches by authors and scholars from the 20th and 21st centuries, periods that were profoundly shaped by exile and migration. While collecting, organizing, and preserving the archive material is one of the essential tasks of the archive and library staff, it is also important to make this material available and share it with the public. One of the ways we do this in Marbach is by curating exhibitions at the Museum of Modern Literature, the newest addition to the Marbach campus. The museum was designed by the British architect David Chipperfield, who had previously designed the reconstruction of the Neues Museum in Berlin. I know it appears smaller from the outside, but on its area of roughly 1,000 square meters, the Museum of Modern Literature often houses three or four exhibitions at the same time. The exhibitions are usually largely based on documents, letters, photographs, film material, objects, and so forth from the archive. Unlike the exhibitions at the Schiller National Museum, they do not usually focus on the biography and works of one author in particular, but they explore different aspects of literature, of writing and reading. One exhibition project that I would like to show you today is our open space project, Narrating Africa, which opened in November 2019. In the case of most traditional exhibitions, you follow a very clear and rigid procedure. First, you choose the material that you want to show, then you prepare it, you group it together, and you provide each exhibit with information. On the day of the exhibition opening, everything is set and the museum visitors can come and observe until a few months later when you take the exhibition apart again and you put the materials back into their archive boxes. Well, Narrating Africa takes a slightly different approach. Let's go inside and take a look. Let's start with the exhibition title. We get a lot of questions about the title, Narrating Africa, mostly because it is a very broad title, an almost impossibly broad title. Namibian writer Remy Gamitsche phrases this very well when he says the following about the exhibition title.
By its very nature, it shows the impossibility of the task. To narrate Africa is impossible because of language, because of barriers, because of the geographic size of the landmass, and mostly because of the different peoples that make up its very big territory.
To truly narrate Africa is impossible. It is a continent with over 50 countries, with different peoples who speak over 1,500 different languages. Where would you even start? How can you even attempt to do justice to all of these different languages and voices? And at the same time, this approach is very freeing because it allows us to look at different narratives of Africa and read them alongside one another. So by doing this, we can trace, discuss, and challenge different conceptions, stereotypes, fantasies, and modes, both past and present, of narrating Africa. But having all of these voices and narratives side by side has two consequences. First, this cannot be a static exhibition. It can never be a finished product. It needs to change and develop. And second, this exhibition project cannot be curated by just one person or by a small group of curators, like most museum exhibitions are. It is imperative that we incorporate many voices of many languages. So for this reason, we invited our project partners at the University of Namibia, as well as researchers from other institutions in Germany and Switzerland, to join us in curating this exhibition. We asked them, which text, which object, which picture do you think belongs in a space that revolves around different ways of narrating Africa? And each of the curators then selected a text or object that they wish to present and discuss. And you can now see the results of their answers in the shape of the tables here in this room. Let me say a few words about the idea behind these tables that were designed for this open space project by Sonja Schwarz and Abdelhamid Amur, two students of the State Academy of Fine Arts in Stuttgart. And as you can see, I'm sat down now. These tables were designed in this way to encourage you to sit down. As you can see, they are very low. The idea is that you stop and you sit down and you really engage with what is in front of you rather than quickly browsing and moving on. What you have in front of you is, first of all, a copy of the text that was chosen by the curator. And printed across the table is a quotation from the text that is being discussed, a quotation that the curator thought was particularly striking or relevant, and several cards that you can pick up, turn over, and read. These cards will give you more information about the curator and the text that is being presented and discussed. So we ask the curators to answer questions such as, why did you pick this text? And what information do I need to know in order to understand this text and the context in which it was written? So the tables are designed in a way that encourages you to explore and engage with each text, object, or image, literally by picking up each card and turning it over. Another convenient aspect is that you can keep adding cards at a later stage. In the last couple of months, we started adding commentary cards, which is a way of adding comments or questions that people have had in response to the tables. The other thing that you will notice about these tables is that they're very light and that they are not bolted to the floor. They are, in fact, quite easy to move. The key idea is that the exhibition space will develop and change over time in several steps. These tables are not fixed, but can and will be moved around. To give you an idea of numbers, so far, and I'm saying this in August 2020, 40 tables have been curated all in all for step one. But not all of these tables are on display at the same time. There are two rooms, the main room and an adjoining smaller room, which I will show you in just a few minutes. The existing tables have been curated by museum and archive staff, as well as researchers from the universities of Duisburg-Essen and Stuttgart and the Basler Afrika Bibliographien in Switzerland. As a result, the Open Space Project currently relies mostly on archive material, as well as canonical German literary texts, but hopefully, over the next couple of months, this will be balanced out by the addition of more external and contemporary material. We're currently planning an international literature festival, Narrating Africa Step 2, and we have invited authors from Africa and authors from Europe who have a connection to Africa to come to Marbach and read from their works to discuss literature from and about Africa and ways of narrating Africa with us, and also to contribute to this exhibition project. We have now to postpone the festival until 2021 due to COVID-19. But the performances, lectures, and debates created as part of the Literature Festival will also be incorporated into the Narrating Africa exhibition project as texts, audio and video clips, and soundscapes. The Literature Festival will mark the biggest shift in the two project rooms in the museum. The new tables featuring contemporary voices will take center stage in the main room, whereas the historical texts will be moved into the adjoining room, where they will still be available to visitors. At the moment, this room is structured chronologically. Here, we have the earliest texts starting in the 19th century. You then make your way slowly through the 20th century until you reach the 21st century. Hopefully, when we show you this room again in just a couple of months, it will look completely different. This table was curated by Sandra Richter, the director of the German Literature Archive, and the text she has chosen to discuss here is a novel by Frieda von Bülow entitled Tropenkoller, which was published in 1895 and was the first German language colonial bestseller. Frieda von Bülow is a very interesting character. She lived in Zanzibar and in German East Africa, as it was called at the time, for a number of years in the 1880s and 1890s, where she founded medical wards and organized charity events. She quite enjoyed life abroad, where she felt she was free from the strict social conventions that were placed particularly on women in Wilhelmine society in the German Empire. Until her death in 1909, Frieda von Bülow enjoyed a reputation of being a nonconformist and an emancipated woman. But her flouting of conventions often led to conflict with colonial as well as native authorities. When offering tours of the exhibition, I often begin discussing this table by asking groups, what do you think this title even means? What does Tropenkoller mean? One of the central terms of the colonial era, Tropenkoller, literally tropical fever, refers to a nervous irritability allegedly caused by the extreme climate. In reality, and von Bülow's narrator exposes this, it was a term used in order to absolve colonial officers of guilt in front of courts of law, thus allowing them to act towards the African population with utmost brutality. In her novel, von Bülow explores and challenges this term, which became one of the key words of the colonial discourse, the alleged Tropenkoller of the colonial officers. There is a lot to unpack and explore here, as Sandra Richter highlights in her discussion of this novel and its author. The role of women and the emancipation of women in German colonialism, and questions such as how can we identify and contextualize ideologically charged terms such as Tropenkoller in order to find a shared language, but also how did von Bülow's contemporaries read and perceive her novel? Moving on from the 1890s to the 1920s, the exhibition project devotes these four tables behind and in front of me to Kurt Tucholsky and Hans Grimm, two authors who, one might say, were opposing ends of the spectrum in the colonial discourse in Germany at the time. This table, again curated by Sandra Richter, discusses Hans Grimm's 1926 best-selling novel Volk ohne Raum, People Without Space, which is for the most part set in South Africa and Namibia. Grimm had spent several years in South Africa as a young man, after first coming there in 1897, first working and later owning a trading company in Port Elizabeth and East London, and then also as a press officer for several Berlin newspapers. In 1910, Grimm returned to Germany to attend university and pursue his career as a writer. His most important novel, People Without Space, was inspired by the loss of the German colonies after the end of the First World War, and it combines anti-capitalist and pro-colonial arguments that were popular in Germany at the time. The novel was a huge success on its publication, at least if you look at it in terms of numbers of copies sold. Despite its length, at 1,300 pages, the novel can hardly be considered light reading. The novel sold over 160,000 copies within the first year. Clearly, these ideas resonated with a lot of people, and the novel's title later gained further notoriety, as the slogan of the National Socialist Party's expansionist power politics in the 1930s and 40s. So we wanted to use this opportunity to ask, who exactly read this novel from start to finish? What exactly did the reader enjoy or criticize about it? But also, how was it marketed? Among the archive material connected to Hans Grimm that is held here in Marbach, we found several photographs of bookshop windows advertising the novel. And this one was particularly striking, which seems rather extreme or exaggerated from our point of view today, with its animal horns, various body parts and masks and so forth. But we can ask, what does this tell us about people's ideas and perceptions of Africa in the late 1920s? This second table was curated by Heike Freireis, the director of the Marbach Museums, and it explores the large collection of Hans Grimm's private photographs that is held in the Marbach archive. During his time in South Africa, Grimm had traveled extensively through the country and he had taken many photographs. What we see here are often very stereotypical and sometimes troubling images. Grimm returning from a safari, proudly showing off the animals that he shot, riding a camel, inspecting a diamond field, and so forth. And usually he does all of these things dressed impeccably in a light colored suit with his bow ties and braces, his hair well kempt and neatly parted down the middle, all of which appears to us eminently impractical and out of place given the climate and wilderness of his surroundings. One of Grimm's harshest, and I might add, most entertaining critics is Kurt Tucholsky. We have two tables here discussing Tucholsky's response to the colonial discourse in Germany at the time. One of them has been curated by Sandra Richter and the other by Marisa Taranis. Moving on from the 1890s to 1930, the exhibition project devotes two tables to Kurt Tucholsky, one of the harshest and, I might add, most entertaining critics of German colonialism around 1930. This table, discussing Tucholsky's response to the colonial discourse in Germany at the time, was curated by Marisa Taranis, who is currently a doctoral student at the University of Stuttgart. The text she has chosen is an article published in January 1930 in The World Stage, a weekly journal edited by Tucholsky himself. The article is entitled Colonial Ball. It is only a few paragraphs long, but is an excellent example of Tucholsky's ability to combine acute social and political analysis with a waspish satirical sense of humor. Newspapers and journals at the time often published reports of high society dances and balls so that the public could read about and dream of the lavish decorations, of energetic dancing, and of elegant people, the latest film stars, political ambassadors, or even royalty, wearing fashionable suits and dresses attending the event. Tucholsky's fictitious report, however, quickly puts an end to such fantasies. The elegant hosts are revealed to be state institutions who are colluding with land speculators. The guests, moreover, are exposed as representatives of colonial societies and, quote, those who desire to become representatives. The walls of the ballroom, Tucholsky continues, were plastered with land maps drawn on coconut leaves, a far cry away from the luxurious and exotic decorations many people at the time would have expected from a colonial ball. Tucholsky deconstructs these exoticized fantasies and instead highlights the harsh realities of colonialism. In a discussion of Tucholsky's satirical article, Marisa Taranis points out that while we do not know for sure that Tucholsky's colonial ball was based on or inspired by a specific event, there was an annual festivity in Berlin since 1920 with the motto Tropical Night Under Palm Trees, which had quickly become one of the most important events of the winter season. When Tucholsky's article was published in 1930, it was 12 years since Germany had been a colonial power, and members of the country's political parties, including the emergent Nazi Party, were divided on the question of whether Germany should focus on land speculation at home or revive German imperialism abroad. Organizing colonial balls were thus a way of indulging in colonial fantasies without having to act on them. Moving on to the 1960s, this table, curated by Heike Freireis, the director of the Marbach Museums, is centered around an African mask that is held in the archive in the collection of Norbert Elias. In 1962, 65-year-old sociologist Norbert Elias traveled to the recently decolonized Ghana, where he held a position as visiting professor until 1964. During his stay in Ghana, he began collecting African masks, and back in 1970, his collection was exhibited in Leicester, in Great Britain. Today, the largest part of the Elias collection is held in the Netherlands. This mask is the only mask from the collection that has made its way to Marbach. It raised a lot of questions for us, and it also shows the gaps in our archive catalog. In the archive's inventory list, it is recorded as a wooden mask of the Senufo people, an ethnic group whose language is today spoken parts of the Ivory Coast and in Mali. We're not exactly certain where it originated. We don't know why or how Elias acquired this mask. From his notes, it appears that he collected them rather randomly, at least at first. We're not sure why, among the numerous masks in Elias' collection, this particular one was brought to Marbach. And another question that we were faced with was, how does one exhibit a mask such as this in an appropriate way? We're uncertain what exactly the function, if that's not too pragmatic a term to use, of this mask was. Might this have been part of a religious or cultural ceremony? Was this a piece that was simply sold to European tourists? So how does one display a mask like this that has been removed from its country of origin? As a work of art on a white cube, this is what we choose to do here, or should one try to contextualize it by replicating a ritualistic scene? And does this also raise questions of appropriation and repatriation? This table was curated by Doug Henriksen, a Namibian historian with a special focus on African history, who is a researcher at the Basler Afrika Bibliographien Archive in Switzerland and lecturer at the Department of History at the University of Basel. Doug Henriksen chose a document found in the archive in Basel. It is an edition of the first African newspaper in Namibia, the Southwest News, which was published by young African activists in a township in Windhoek, the Namibian capital, in 1960. The page that is shown here is the first page with articles in German, English, and Otjiherero. One of the articles printed here is a speech, which is in German, held by Zedekiah Ngavirua, who today holds the position of special representative for Namibian-German negotiations within the Namibian government at the Congress of African Teachers in Windhoek on oppression and self-help. It is fascinating to see how the first African and, according to its subtitle, first non-racial Namibian newspaper published by African journalists, was written in African languages, as well as those of European colonizers, such as German. This is the adjoining room that we have dubbed the workshop room. Whereas the tables in the main room are sort of all set up and fixed, the idea is that visitors can come in here and put together the tables that they like to see and that interest them particularly. So we have the tabletops over here, and we have the additional material and the cards printed on the other side. And then you can go to this table and put together the things that you're particularly interested in.
War das viel Arbeit? Viel Arbeit.
Man muss arbeiten. Aber wenn zwei ist, ist nicht so sehr. Wenn sie alleine, muss er in einem Haus arbeiten.
So this is where we're at now, and like I said earlier, the project will continue to change and develop as we add more table and take the next steps of this project. So look out for updates and for new videos as we document the process of this exhibition. Look out for more information on the Literature Festival that would hopefully happen as planned in 2021. And thank you for joining me today.